Hello, this is Dr. Manish Kothari from consultant spine surgeon at Just Loop Hospital. So we're going to be talking about vertebroplasty today. So when we talk of any surgery, we talk about the goals of the surgery. In case of vertebroplasty, we're looking at what the goals being pain relief, avoiding complications, and preventing collapse of the fractured vertebra in the near and short term. So there are, of course, we have to choose our patient carefully. And based on these goals, we want to not have complications. And this is decided by the fracture type. And we have to choose the patient according to the what fracture we are seeing. So the types of fracture by the simplified AO classification is the A1, 2, 3, 4, and B type. B type isolated vertebroplasty is a clear contraindication. Let's look at the A types one by one. So the A1 fractures are isolated superior or inferior end plate fractures, most commonly superior ones. The adjacent disc is usually quite okay. There is no deformity on standing x-rays. They present quite early and many of them will actually heal conservatively. And if you have to do a vertebroplasty, a targeted vertebroplasty at the fracture end is going to give you good results. The A2 type is slightly trickier. It's the pincer type. This is common in osteoporotic. In this, both the end plates are fractured horizontally, that is coronally, and there is not a significant burst component. Mind you, the adjacent disc is not significantly degenerated, but over time, if these are neglected, they will become degenerated because of the movement. And the special part about these fractures are they tend to go in non-union or and progressive kyphosis. So if you look at this paper by Goldstein et al, they looked at all conservatively managed osteoporotic fractures, and they found that the A2 and the A4 types had the highest risk of collapses. A2 has the highest risk of kyphosis development, and they also have highest risk of developing a cleft, which is the osteovertebral necrosis. And the cases in which there is the A2 or A4 type along with the cleft, they have the highest chance of a vertebra plana or significant collapse. So this is one case where this is an A2 fracture with an anterior wall fracture will easily become a vertebra plana, as we see. And this is a vertebra plana established. So you look at the patient in prone position, how it opens up, and in sitting, it becomes completely split. If you see, the split is horizontally here. The rest of the vertebra is intact. In fact, that split is now pushing the vertebra inside the spinal canal, causing deficit. So another study, they looked at a newer system in different types of fractures, and they found that the A2 type was a risk factor and was actually a contraindication for an isolated vertebroplasty. Next, we look at the A3 and the A4 types of fractures, which are the posterior wall fractures. The main concern in these is that is posterior cement leak. And many a times the cementing is actually still possible depending on the fracture anatomy and the age of the fracture. So it becomes a relative contraindication. We'll see how. So this one paper from European Spine Journal, they looked at 110 A3 fractures, isolated, simple, stable burst fractures. And they had a high number of cement leak, although the cement leak was not mentioned whether it was spinal or paravertebral. Nonetheless, they had a high rate of cement leak, but no clinically significant change in the result. Another study by Perez et al, they looked at 157 fractures, and they did a balloon kyphoplasty, not vertebroplasty, and they had 9% spinal canal leak, but none were symptomatic. Similar study with kyphoplasty, not vertebroplasty. These were the ones with posterior wall injury, and they had no spinal leak. Obviously, so you can see that the technique also makes a difference, and obviously the experience of the person doing it will also make some difference with regard to cement leak. Another interesting study is this was a kyphoplasty versus instrumented kyphoplasty. So on one side was isolated kyphoplasty, and on the other side was screw fixation plus kyphoplasty in fractures with posterior wall injury, and they found they both had clinically same results. So kyphoplasty alone in these patients will work well with no cement leak, and it provides good stability as equal to pedicle screw fixation as well. So when we look at burst fractures, you see these are a simple burst fracture is actually stable. Once both the end plates are gone, and if there is an A2 component, it will become actually unstable and cause cord compression. but there are certain different types of fractures which we see especially in osteoporosis called as the vertebral osteonecrosis or non-union, also called as Kummel's lesion. In such cases, initially, vertebroplasty was the gold standard. But however, there have been recent reports in the last decade that they can cause late collapse or late instability because we'll see later. So there's another paper by Lim et al. They presented two patients who developed post-vertebroplasty instability in the long term and which required fixation. Another patient from Bombay by Dr. Nene et al. They presented five patients with post-vertebroplasty instability. So there you can see on the left side a very well done vertebroplasty going into collapse. Another one very well done vertebroplasty going into collapse. You can see that there is a halo around the vertebroplasty which was not there initially. And the third patient which nature kind of took care of, they formed a large osteophyte anteriorly and laterally and the patient did not require any further intervention. So they reported 7% incidence of late instability. Of which two were intervertebral and three were intervertebral. So it involved the disc as well. The hypothesis being that the cement acts like a rock in between the cushions of soft osteoporotic bones. Another similar study, they found the solid pattern of cement distribution causes late collapse. And five out of eight such late collapses had intravertebral cleft. So now we are looking at these cleft formation, which is very common, almost exclusively seen in osteoporosis, which makes it difficult to classify them as per the AO classification. But we need to be aware there is a separate classification. So this classification was actually originally described by Howard Steele, 1955, but various authors have kind of built on it. And there are these stage one, stage two, stage three, of Kummel's lesion, all with increasing instability. So they give various parameters. You can read up this paper by Chia et al. And another one by Formica et al. They've given the sagittal and angular kyphosis and sagittal alignment parameters. Basically, the idea being that in which patients you can do isolated vertebroplasty and in which patients you will have to do some form of fixation and reconstruction, which you need to read the paper and understand. Another paper which properly selected their patients and they had good results in vertebroplasty and they found that vertebroplasty is far simpler than a kyphoplasty in stable Kummel lesions, right? In metastatic lesions, overall it has good results in pain alleviation and treatment of instability, but those with posterior wall incomplete or those with extension of epidural component, they will have cement leaks which can be dangerous. However, less leaks are seen if the patient has had prior treatment with either radioembolization or some form of ablation. These are known to have less leaks because the tumor has kind of melted and has left a vacuum which you can fill with the cement. And there are of course other generic contraindications. Important here is that you need to rule out an missed infection. So many a times you see a brain, you see an MRI, which is only a screening is done and it is reported as a fracture, but it may be a very early infection which is missed. So any doubt, always do a contrast study before you look for a vertebroplasty. Now let's come to the technique. So before starting, what we will need is, what I commonly use is local anesthesia. You'll need the needle. This is a Jamshedi needle. Preferably, I use Cook needles because they are very sharp and they are placement of the needle becomes much easier. You will need cement. There are various vertebroplasty cements available. The cheapest one available is a Simplex P half dose, which is antibiotic loaded, but it is not as radio opaque. To make it properly radio opaque for a vertebroplasty, you need to add barium sulfate cement to it. Which can be ETO'd in paper packs, and you need general instruments like hammer and blade and so on. So very important is that these cements have to be kept in the fridge to increase the working time. We are all aware of that. So you make sure that the cement is inside the OT in the fridge a good 2 to 3 hours, ideally the night before itself, it should be in the fridge. Now, we need to prepare the trolley before we take the patient in, because we'll be doing this patient under local anesthesia and sedation. We need to prepare the trolley and keep it ready. The sister should be scrubbed. The patient is going to be in severe pain, so will not tolerate a prone position for too long. So this is the armamentarium that you will need, the needles, and you need 1 cc syringes, ideally lower lock, but if you don't have the lower lock, that is also okay. Mind you, the cement is still in the fridge. You won't call for it until the needles are in. So this is the local anesthesia. So I use 10 ml of Anavin 0.25, 10 ml lignocaine, and I add 1 ml to this concoction of soda bicarb, and you add drop by drop only, because if it becomes turbid, you cannot use it. You protect yourself, of course, with lead apron, thyroid shield, and leaded goggles as well. Now comes the important part, is the positioning. You will connect all monitors to the patient. You position the pillow under the chest, basically whatever position the patient finds it comfortable, because these patients are in pain. Prone position will open up the fracture and will cause more pain. So you have to make the patient comfortable in whatever way possible. You ask the patient, where do you need supports and pillows, and give it to them accordingly. I don't use any of the bolsters because it causes more pain. You just let the patient be and give them support as they ask. The hands can go above. You don't need to keep the hands like this. This is the position where the patients find it most comfortable. Now, before we start, you take a good AP view. A basic rule of any AP imaging of the spine is you have to square the vertebra. Many a times these vertebra are already fractured, so you don't see the end plates. As you can see, the end plate is crooked and not a straight line. So either you look at the end plate, the lower or the upper end plate, whichever is intact, of the same vertebra, or you can use the end plates of the adjacent levels. Next, you want to make sure that the spinous process is in the midline, there is no rotation. Third is, instead of tilting the C-arm for AP view every time, what I do is I make sure I adjust the table in whatever position I want, so that my C-arm remains the same. It becomes easy for the technician, it's also very fast for the technician. That one less movement will give you extra 30 seconds of every time, right? So as you can see, you adjust the table to get a square vertebra in a neutral C-arm position. Next, you give local anesthesia. Sedation is only SOS. If the patient is not tolerating, then the anesthetist is ready with IV sedation. Otherwise, it is purely under local anesthesia. So first you give skin, as you can see in this. And next, I take a spinal needle and I go right up to the periosteum on the bone where my projected entry is going to be. And you inject good amount of local anesthesia. As you can see, I'm getting a feel of the bone here. And you inject into the periosteum so that your requirement for sedation is minimized. Next, you mark the needle entry on the skin itself. You take a stab and you land the needle at the upper and outer quadrant of the pedicle. So on the left side, it will be between 9 and 11, and on the right side, it will be between 1 and 3. As you can see, this is a procedure with bipedicular. I've positioned both the needles on both sides at the appropriate position. At this point, you are at the upper quadrant of the pedicle. Now, the most important part is passing the jamshidi needle through the pedicle. Each vertebra, as you know, has its own direction. The lumbar, as you can see, the lumbar becomes gradually oblique as you go lower down, and the thoracic also will become gradually oblique as you go up. So you need to be aware what level you are doing, and of course, you also need to start at the lateral border. Now you have to medialize the jamshidi so that it reaches to the near the center of the vertebra. So this is somewhat like the distal interlocking of a nail, of the tibial nail. So you have to pass the screw right through the center. The only difference is that here you are starting at the outer edge of the pedicle. So outer end, not in the center as you would do in a distal locking. And you're trying to cross the tunnel obliquely. We'll see in this animation video. So let's look at this scenario. Here, the needle is going into the spinal canal. Why is this happening? Because in the lateral view, you have not yet crushed the posterior border of the vertebra, but in the AP view, you are already crossing the medial border of the pedicle, which means you are inside the spinal canal. Next possibility is that, look at this animation, it's going outside the vertebra. So as you can see, many times the vessels are outside, so you can cause catastrophic bleeding. Why has this happened? Because in the lateral view, you are inside the vertebra, but in the AP view, you are barely touching the lateral side. So this is a red alert. You cannot proceed with this. You need to check your level again. In an ideal position, when you are touching the medial border of the pedicle in AP view, your tip of the needle should have crossed the posterior cortex of the vertebra. This is your ideal position. In this case, you are right inside the pedicle, and as you proceed, you will reach to the center of the vertebra. When you become an expert as this, you may not need a bipedicular vertebroplasty. You can do only a unipedicular vertebroplasty. So next, I look at the needle position. I am very happy with this needle position. I have reached right inside, but I check my needle position always with a dye. This is Omnipaque dye. As you can see, after injection, this has gone into the vertebral venous plexus. It has gone above and below. So I will readjust my needles and bang on. It's on the fracture. So I am now in a good position. Next, we have come at the cement mixing. You know this part. You call the cement from the fridge. You mix the cement as all basic cementing work is. Only thing different is that you have to add barium sulfate. So you take about you remove 1 teaspoon of cement powder, and just about the same amount, you will put it back inside the cement. And then you add the monomer and you start mixing. You put it in a 20cc syringe. You load the syringe and keep a 1cc syringe in front of it. Keep a 1cc cement in front of it, and you start filling your 1cc needles, the syringes. Now you wait for it to become less liquid, rather in a semi-solid condition. So this you see is a toothpaste consistency. As soon as it becomes non-liquid at the toothpaste, you have to start injecting. Now you ask anesthetist to check the vitals and SpO2. Sorry. So this is a quick video of the cementing. This is a Kummel's lesion. As you can see, this is a Kummel's lesion. And I've injected the dye first. I'm making sure that my needles are in the correct position. It's going to fill up the fracture. And now next, I will start injecting the cement. You add only 0.1 cc each time and take pulsed fluoroscopy. You don't take a continuous fluoroscopy. You take a pulsed fluoroscopy one by one. And gradually, with Simplex P in a cold OT, you'll have around 4 to 5 minutes of working. With Simplex P in a hot OT, you have barely 2 minutes. So make sure your OT is very cold and the fringe and the cement has been kept in the fridge. And then you gradually fill up the fracture as much as you want. Don't come too close to the posterior cortex. That is the end of cementing. You remove, once the cement is in, you wait for the cement to set outside. Inside, the cement sets much earlier because it is warm, the body is warmer. Then you remove the needle in gradual rotatory movement so there is no tail of cement behind the that comes out through the pedicle. If you've done under local anesthesia only, you can mobilize the patient right inside the OT itself. The pain relief is so fast. If you use anesthesia sedation, then after 2 to 3 hours, the patient can be mobilized. Let's look at some example. This was an A4 fracture with posterior wall, but because this was a D8 level, it's a relatively stable level. We did a vertebroplasty, and at 1 year follow-up, patient is doing well. Another case, you can see this was a superior end plate fracture. The lower one also partially kind of a bit dipped, but not frankly fractured. But you can see there was not much of angular kyphosis at that level. There was no discovertebral instability. So we did a vertebroplasty and had good results. Thank you.